Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the decommissioning of USS Hunley. I'm Commander Steve Bernasconi, Hunley's last executive officer. I hope you've enjoyed Sinkland Fleet's Navy Band under the direction of musician Senior Chief Harris. In a few minutes, the ceremony will begin. For those of you who are attending your first decommissioning ceremony, let me tell you a little about the customs and traditions regarding this event. There are three major phases in the life of any ship. First, the commissioning, a ship's official acceptance by the Navy, entitling her thereafter to fly the commissioning pennant and to be designated a United States ship. Then a succession of changes of command, wherein a new commanding officer takes over, maintaining continuity of command throughout the life of the ship. Finally, the decommissioning ceremony, terminating the active naval service of a ship. Decommissioning is a celebration of the service life of the ship and a time to honor all the proud crews that have served on board. Today, the final crew departs the ship for the last time. The National Ensign and Commission Pennant are retired. The commanding officer closes out the ship's deck log and orders the last watch secured. In a few minutes, Captain Helfand, the 18th and final commanding officer of USS Hunley, Vice Admiral Emery, Commander Submarine Force, U.S. Atlantic Fleet, Vice Admiral Bacon, United States Navy retired, and Captain Holloway, Commander Submarine Squadron 8, will be arriving. The traditional piping over the side, ruffles and flourishes, and the Admiral's March will be rendered honoring their arrival. Upon completion of the arrival of the official party, we will pay honor to our national ensign with the playing of the national anthem. This will be followed by the invocation as our ceremony begins. Hunley, Aten, Hut! Will the guests please rise for the arrival of the official party and remain standing through the completion of the invocation. Hunley, arriving. Suburon 8, arriving. Sublant, arriving. Vice Admiral, United States Navy, retired, arriving. Parade the colors.
Colors.
Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem. Chaplain Dick Pusateri, former chaplain on Hundley, will now deliver the invocation.
Let us pray. God of all good deeds and worthy purposes, join us as we celebrate the heritage and many contributions of USS Hundley. For 32 years, the men and women of the ship fulfilled their duties, served their nation, preserved the peace, and bettered each other's lives. So rather than a time of sadness as Hundley decommissions, let this be a ceremony of rejoicing in the great things your people have done aboard this ship. Let us be thankful. Amen.
Will the guest please be seated? Hundley, parade, rest. Ladies and gentlemen, Captain William Helfand, Commanding Officer, USS Hundley.
Good morning, Vice Admiral Bacon, Vice Admiral Emery, Rear Admiral Buchanan, Rear Admiral Harness, Rear Admiral Murphy, Commodore Holloway, distinguished guests of Hundley, including plank owners, crew members past and present, family and friends, welcome to the decommissioning ceremony for USS Hundley. I and my crew are really pleased to see so many of you here today to recognize and review the distinguished career of this great ship. In fact, we've had people come from as far as Holy Loch, Scotland, and we welcome you. A ship that has served its country superbly for 32 years. You'll see a letter in your decommissioning program signed by me in which I state that I approach this ceremony with mixed emotions. I'm extremely proud and happy to be able to say that I have served on this fine ship and feel very lucky that I have had the opportunity to serve as her commanding officer. On the other hand, this is a sad day because the Navy and the nation are saying farewell to a great lady, the term affectionately used to describe a U.S. Navy vessel. This ship was clearly capable of serving the United States Navy for many more years. When Hundley was commissioned over 32 years ago, some of you were there. In fact, five of our guests worked for Newport News Shipbuilding and Dry Dock Company constructing Hundley. Newport News Shipbuilding can be very proud of this product. They built a great one. A number of the original crew that oversaw our construction are with us today. These individuals, known as plank owners, did their job well, ensuring that the ship was built to Navy specifications. They tested the equipment for the Navy, took her to sea for the first time, and ran her through her paces, ensuring that all problems were worked out. They made sure that the foundation that would be relied upon for the life of the ship was strong. They should be extremely proud of themselves, especially as they listen to the accomplishments of this ship today. It gives me a great pleasure to welcome the plank owners back. You'll be able to recognize them here and at the reception, as we have asked them to wear badges that say plank owner. Included is Commander Glenn Snell, who is the officer in charge of the initial new construction crew until the commanding officer reported towards the end of the construction period. I'd like all plank owners at this time to stand for a moment so that we can give you a well-earned round of applause. Thank you. As my executive officer has stated, I'm the 18th commanding officer of Hunley. I'm pleased that 9 prior commanding officers of Hunley have joined us today. We are honored by your presence. Our guest speaker, Vice Admiral Bacon, was the 11th commanding officer, and he will be formally introduced to you shortly. At this time, I'd like to introduce the other commanding officers and ask that they stand when they are introduced. And I see a couple of seats are empty, so maybe we weren't able to get all 9. But the first commanding officer of this ship was Captain Douglas Syverson. Served from June 62 to November 63. Second commanding officer was Captain Robert Black, served from November 63 to September 65. Sixth commanding officer was Captain Al Frost, July 70 to March 72. Ninth commanding officer was Captain Leroy Hebbard, January 75 to October 76. Twelfth commanding officer, Captain Robert Lowenthal, June 80 to August 82. Thirteenth commanding officer, Captain Terrence Camilleri, August 82 to July 84. 14th commanding officer, and I'm not sure I see him, is Captain William Hasty. Did he make it here? Don't think so. 17th commanding officer, and the individual I relieved was Captain Tom Kent, July 91 to June 93. One other group that is in our audience are the submarine veterans of World War II. You can pick them out by their bright blue and gold jackets. They're true combat experienced submarine heroes, and you could not find any stronger supporters of today's submarine force. We thank you for all you do. Hunley has the proud distinction of being the first ship designed and built from the keel up to service and maintain the Navy's nuclear-powered fleet ballistic missile submarine fleet. Her biography is included in your brochure, and will be discussed by other speakers today in more detail than I plan to cover. What I'd like to do is reflect back on my personal association with USS Hunley, which goes back to early in my naval career. I'd like to do this because this association, I think, is typical of so many officers who wear gold dolphins and have spent the majority of their time under the ocean's surface, periodically relying on our superb submarine tenders for support. Back in 1972, after I completed the required training, I reported to my first submarine assignment, USS Nathan Hale, SSBN 623 Gold Crew. It was home ported out of Pearl Harbor, operating out of Guam. As was usual, I joined the crew during what we call the off-crew period, while the blue crew had the submarine. And on an editorial note, as I prepared my comments for today, I was surprised when I realized that many of the present crew of Hunley would have no concept of a typical FBM crew turnover, because it's been over 7 years since Hunley has participated in that type of an event. So I'll give a little more detail of the FPM turnover. The relieving crew would fly to the remote location of the submarine, that being Guam. Usually the next day the sub would arrive, and the two crews would take 4 days to turn over responsibility of the sub. Then the relief crew would fly home. So off I went to Guam with the gold crew to meet my first ship. Upon arrival at the pier, I sighted our hotel for the night, USS Hunley. My first night's sleep on a naval vessel as a commissioned officer was aboard this great ship. This ship has served as a home away from home for many submariners over the years. During the next 2 years, as a division officer on that sub, I would rely on the tender services many times. Most of the time, her work would be taken for granted. Jobs such as sheet metal, naugahyde, photo engraving, calibration. But when the most difficult equipment problems came, needing repair beyond the capabilities of the submarine crew, we knew where to turn, USS Hunley. Later in my career as executive officer on USS George C. Marshall, Hunley supported us out of Charleston, South Carolina, just prior to Marshall starting an overhaul. When we came out of overhaul 2 years later, she was on station in Holyrock, Scotland, ready and waiting to support us again. During my tour as commanding officer on USS Phoenix, SSN 702, while deployed in the Atlantic Ocean, Hunley was there once again in Holyrock, ready to replenish us with fresh fruit and vegetables and provide our mail that she had been holding while we were deployed. And finally, in 1987, Hunley supported my last upkeep during my tour on Phoenix here in Norfolk. I think it's easy to see why I'm so fond of this ship and why I was so pleased to have been given the opportunity to serve as her commanding officer. From Hunley's first Liberty Port in Mobile, Alabama, to her last in Key West, Florida, she has proudly traveled the world. You will note in her biography a number of trips from the East Coast to Holyrock, over 3,000 miles, or to Guam, over 9,000 miles. Most of you are very familiar with the duties of a tender. For those of you that are not, a tender's mission is to provide anything and everything it can to ensure that the submarines it supports has everything they need to be ready to carry out their missions when called upon. But this tender has provided much more to take care of our people over the years. Electricity, water, medical and dental, dispersing, mail, legal services, chaplet support are some of them. Hunley has faithfully answered the call for over three decades. She witnessed the rise of communism and the escalation of the nuclear threat and played an important role in the United States' efforts to counter the threat through the use of our strategic subs. Along the way, Hunley was awarded numerous departmental and ship awards, and those are discussed in your brochures. Ironic as it may seem, Hunley is a victim of her own success. As a result of the end of the Cold War, Hunley is being decommissioned years ahead of the previous schedule in support of the military's downsizing. I talked to the ship, but she is only a part of the total package. A lot has changed since 1962. Back then, a postage stamp was 4 cents, gas was 28 cents a gallon, the average price of a car was $3,000, and the minimum wage was $1.15. I was in the eighth grade. There's one thing that has not changed. The people that have made up the crew of Hunley during these 32 years have remained totally dedicated, superb professionals. They gave the ship its life and earned the ship its exceptional reputation. When you take a crew of 1,300 and consider their many talents, they can accomplish just about anything. My crew included 500 women, 38% of the crew. You've heard a lot in the press about problems with integrating women in military commands over the last several years, whether they can handle it, and if it will cause a breakdown of good order and discipline. This ship has had women on it for years, and they have done their fair share with flying colors. All minorities have been well represented in my crew, working in harmony to accomplish very difficult tasks. I will briefly comment on some of the accomplishments just of the most recent couple of years. And I do this not so much to compliment my specific crew, although I'm extremely proud of them, but to give you a flavor of the versatility and capabilities of the Hunley crews, present and past. I'm sure that each of the other 17 commanding officers could provide a similar story for their command tour. Of course, the normally expected achievements are the superlative repair, support of the submarines, and the successful periodic inspections and certifications. But the total involvement goes much further for these marvelous crew members. Surface ships have also been supported when needed, not only with equipment repairs, but also in providing hundreds of shortwave radio telephone patches for those that are deployed. Last year, Hunley provided this support for ships off the coast of Somalia. Hunley has hosted tours for VIPs, such as our Secretary of the Navy and the Chief of Naval Operations of the Uruguay Navy in the last year. International relations were strengthened last spring when Hunley provided emergent repairs to an Argentine submarine and provide interpreters for them during their port visit in Norfolk. Hunley crew members were provided on short notice last fall to support Haitian response efforts. Hunley has also provided support to the local community, and in so doing has strengthened the Navy-Tidewater relationship. Hunley has worked with the Ghent Elementary School for the past 5 years in the Personal Excellence Partnership Program, serving as tutors and role models to the children and taking on projects such as building shelves for the classrooms. And I'm glad today that we have the principal and the representative that was so close with us here joining us for the ceremony. Hunley has excelled in raising money for the combined federal campaign. For those of you that are not familiar with that term, it's the military's equivalent of the United Way. For example, Hunley raised over $56,000 in 93 campaign alone. That's a typical amount for 1 year for Hunley. Hunley crew members have been key contributors to the Habitat for Humanity project. This involves building a new home in downtown Norfolk for a family that would otherwise not be able to have a home. When it came time for helping others, Hunley was in the lead. And speaking of helping others, Hunley's presence extended well beyond the community. In 1989, Hunley assisted people in Charleston, South Carolina, in the wake of Hurricane Hugo. In 92, under Captain Tom's Kent leadership, Hunley provided significant assistance to Southern Florida in their efforts to recover from the devastation of Hurricane Andrew. Hunley was directly responsible for refurbishing and reopening 16 schools and one orphanage and for handling over 5,000 Federal Emergency Management Act claims. It's amazing how many carpenters, plumbers, and electricians there were in Hunley's crew. For its efforts, Hunley was recognized by the Points of Light Foundation, presented awards by the Governor of Florida, and awarded the Humanitarian Service Medal by the Navy. Hunley is also noted for its self-help efforts. She's been recognized by the Tidewater Ombudsman Council as having the most active and successful ombudsman. I have had four outstanding individuals serving for me: Terry Frank, Debbie Allen, Susan Holder, and Judy Ledford. Only Debbie's husband is still a member of the crew. The others transferred over the last several months. Through their enthusiasm and conscientiousness, they have taken care of our Hunley families exceptionally well during times of need or unusual stress. One example was the raising of money through volunteer efforts for a program we called Holiday Assistance. This program provided about 90 families of our crew with complete holiday meals last Thanksgiving and then again at Christmas. These were families who would not have been able to afford that type of meal otherwise. The Ombudsman, our chaplain department, led by Chaplain Pusateri, have been some of my most treasured assets in Hunley's efforts to take care of our people. Thanks so much to you. To get the most from the people, they need to enjoy their work environment and feel that their interests are being taken care of. And in order to do that for a crew of 1,300, takes a lot of effort by a lot of people and a lot of time. Hunley has done this extremely well. This was formally recognized recently when the ship was awarded the Golden Anchor Award by Commander-in-Chief, U.S. Atlantic Fleet. Hunley was selected as the best ship in her category for retention and personnel management programs. And I couldn't allow this ceremony to pass without complimenting the many people who have earned that award. It starts with the officers in the wardroom, especially the XO and department heads, the chiefs, relying on the leadership of the Command Master Chief, and I've had two great ones, Master Chief Chuck Greer and Master Chief Dexter Dean, and the chain of command under the chiefs that run the ship. I've never been in a command where I've seen it run better than I have here on Hunley. And it goes much further than that to properly take care of the people. I've already mentioned the chaplain and the ombudsman. It takes the command career counselors, the administrative office, personnel office, pay office, food and service division, sales and service division, medical and dental, legal office, and safety department. That's just to mention some of them. I don't have time to mention the others. But all of those assets work to take care of the crew. I've been blessed with more than 55 exceptional officers to run this ship. In fact, my secret is that they have made my job extremely easy. Many are limited duty officers and warrant officers, and I'd like to talk about that category just for a moment. The individuals that have been selected over the years for the LDO and warrant officer commissioning programs were selected because they were the cream of the crop of all the enlisted personnel in the Navy, both as leaders and in technical expertise. Tenders have served as an environment where these individuals have developed their officer skills. Many have continued to serve and assume positions of significant responsibility. This point was driven home to me the end of July when I attended the change of command for the floating dry dock Resolute, just down the piers here. The outgoing commanding officer, Lieutenant Commander Mac McCarthy, the relieving officer, Lieutenant Commander Bill Hendy, and the guest speaker, Captain Bruce Gustin, who is presently head of the Submarine and Nuclear Power LDO Warrant Officer Assignment Branch at the Bureau of Naval Personnel, all served their first assignments here as an officer on board Hunley. I'm pleased to have all three of you in the audience today. Clearly, Hunley has been a training ground for developing these superb naval officers. As for the many supply officers and other staff officers in my personal wardroom, I couldn't imagine having a better team. In addition to the ship itself and the crew, there's a third essential ingredient required for the total success of the ship. I'm referring to the spouses and the families of the crew members. They provide outstanding support and encouragement to keep all of us doing a very challenging job. They're the best cheerleaders we could ask for. Additionally, oftentimes a family must face crises and moves while a service member is not available. Hundley's families have done this repeatedly for 32 years. As a symbolic gesture of thanks to all of the families who have supported this ship over the years, I now would like to present flowers to my wife, Emily Ray, my executive officer's wife, Karen DeGusto, my command master chief's wife, Susan Dean, and my one remaining ombudsman, Debbie Allen. Please join me in a well-deserved round of applause for all the families of Hundley, past and present. I'd like to take this opportunity to tell you Hundley is going out in top-notch shape. In 1992, during Captain Tom Kent's tour, Hundley was preparing for a Mediterranean Sea deployment. The ship's boilers and diesel engines were overhauled, as were the evaporators. The heads and berthing facilities were renovated. The personnel office was remodeled. These were only examples of upgrades accomplished. This was all before the decision was made to decommission Hundley. During my tour, additional repairs were completed on several of the diesels. All 10 motors on the port and starboard boat and missile cranes were rebuilt to ensure those cranes would be ready to support the ship's offload. For the past 3 years, Hundley made every underway on the day scheduled. I challenge you to find another tender that can make that claim. During our last underway, the chief engineer basked in the glory of all 10 diesel engines purring and boasted to me as the ship answered a design flank belt. Not an unusual event over the past few years for Hundley.